Welcome back, rankers. Not much happening in the world of SEO news this week, so I thought I'd continue on with where we left off last week. Now, you may remember, we're talking about a five-step SEO roadmap. What that means is, before you start on any SEO campaign, you need to understand where you are right now. How rubbish is your site? How much does your site suck in the eyes of Google? So we went through all those little things and we did a bit of a site review to take you through those bits and pieces. The blog post, if you didn't read it, if you only saw the video, go and have a read the blog post as well, where we go through webmaster tools, the health check, the different things you need to look at in webmaster tools, content keywords, the index check, keyword research, content assessment, case check, blah, 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 and on it goes. So they're the things you need to work through just to even know where you are before you even get started on the actual SEO. Today, I want to take a look at where do you go to from here. Now, for this exercise, I'm going to assume you don't have a site, okay? And so you're going to start from scratch. Well, this is what I do and what the rest of the team here does when they're talking to clients who may be looking for a new site. First of all, we build in a good CMS. So we build in a thing called WordPress, which many of you may love and know. Then, based on our keywords, I take a look at, okay, what do we want to rank for? What do we want to have authority for? Well, just to say this was an SEO site that I was setting up. Well, backlinks, people are always searching about, keyword research, on-page SEO, site performance and webmaster tools. They're some main areas that people are always asking about when it comes to SEO. And within each of these, we'll have topics about, you know, say backlinks. You know, we'll have topics about what's a bad backlink, what's a good backlink. We'll have topics about techniques to get backlinks. Things like guest blogging, is that a good idea or not? Things like directory submissions, is that a good idea? Things like that, Google Places, all of that sort of stuff. Where do you get your backlinks from? Under the keyword research, we'll go and have a look at the different tools that are out there, different ways to elicit information from friends and family and customers about what sort of keywords that you should be targeting. And one of the biggest questions you can always ask someone about keywords is this: if you were looking for a product or service like mine, what would you type into Google? And you see, that's totally devoid of any keywords. Because as soon as you mention a keyword, as soon as you say, hey, if you were looking for a company that makes blue widgets in Hawthorne, what would you... You know what they're going to say, right? So, don't mention your keywords when you ask that question. If you were looking for a product or service like mine, what would you type into Google? That's how you start to get some feedback. You'd be surprised what comes back. Phrases you may never have thought of. Then you can take that information and go and use some of the tools we talked about. So that's where what we'd be putting under keyword research. On-page SEO, this is like writing a giant blog post, right? You've got to think of the sections, you've got to chunk it out. You've got to think of the sections that are important to your audience and what you want to rank for, and then think of all the subheadings underneath that. Now, for instance, last week, and that's just the structure of the content of the site. So how do you do an actual page? We've been through this a few times, but I just want to show you last week's as an example. So the title of last week's video and blog post, the title of the blog post was SEO Roadmap. The title of the video was SEO Site Review. Okay, so first of all, I'll just go across to Firefox. And we'll go and have a look at, Google's locked me out there. We'll go and have a look at, say, SEO Roadmap and see where we rank for that. We're right down here on this page, but I'm on Google.com. So in Google.com, we ranked, one... 2, 3, 4, 5. Number 4 if you count the video embed on smartcompany.com.au. But the thing is about smartcompany.com.au, that's classed as a news site, so that's always going to get its own entry if it's on a news site. So if we go to .com.au, see where that site page ranks for that in .com.au. So essentially we're number one, number two there. Once again, Smart Company is getting far much more kudos than our own site because it's a massive news site that everyone talks about, everyone links to, prolific with the amount of content that it pumps out. So of course, it's always gonna rank higher than mine for the same phrase. You might find though, because it is a news site, it is time sensitive, this may move above that one over a period of time. So why is this page, say, ranking for SEO roadmap? I'll show you in a second. The other thing I want to check is the video ranking. How did that go? SEO site review. I haven't actually checked this. I don't think it would have done terribly well because it's a fairly generic term and we didn't do a lot of work on the optimization of the video. So let's just go and have a look in videos. No, so there's plenty of there that's, hang on, that's SEO roadmap. Try that again. SEO site review in videos. There's plenty there above me, which I would have expected because I certainly didn't go out to rank for that in YouTube. And there's a number of techniques which we've been through before about how to get ranked in YouTube. All right, so SEO roadmap. Let's go and have a look at the site in Firefox. And we'll use Aaron Wall's tool to analyze this page. Okay, so this tool will tell me all the SEO elements that are on the page. Okay, right up here, this H4, and some people have said, hey Jim, that looks really terrible. That, yeah, it does, it looks disgusting. And I know, but we're in the middle of building a new site. Not a good place to have H4. Anyway, long story, we're getting rid of it. But you'll see the title of the post, and this automatically happens with WordPress if you've got it set up properly. Immediately, we have a H1 here. Immediately, we have the friendly URL here. Immediately, we have the same title in the page, okay? So you get that consistency. So we're sort of clobbering Google over the head a little bit. Some of you out there have said to me, oh, that's keyword stuffing. No, it's not. It's a logical use of the phrase. If you're writing a Word document, always take this back to what these tags and these elements are designed to do. They're to tell a human about the document. Right? So essentially, this Ceph, search engine friendly URL, that's the file name, right? This up here, that's the actual title, the meta tag of the tag of the document. If I was tagging a Word document, this would be the title of it. Up here, this is the first heading of the document. It makes perfect sense. It's not keyword stuffing, it's not overdoing it, it's just using common sense. These H3s over here, I don't like. I'm getting rid of them, right? It's illogical to have them there. Then down the page here, we've got a H2, and then within that H2, under that H2, we've got a H3, we've got a H4, H4, H4. Now, these are all logically inserted in the blog post, okay? They're there for a reason, because they are all subheadings, and this is a bit out of kilter, this tool here. It's not showing you which ones, but these are all, like under, under the health check, we've got all of these. So we've got the main heading here of H2 of Webmaster Tools. Then under Webmaster Tools, we're going into health check and explaining then all the things that come in under health check in Webmaster Tools. So using H2, H3, H4 is logical. It's not absolutely necessary, but it makes good sense to do so. So it shows a well-structured document. The other thing that you would do, if you go and look for SEO roadmap throughout this page, you might find it once or twice, okay? But the idea is that you're using language around the topics that you're talking about that are relevant to that topic. So gone are the days of, you know, trying to use the word, like this idea of keyword density, is it 3% or is it 5%? Forget about it, okay? It's not about that. It's about creating content that makes sense to your audience for the keywords that they're typing in. So yes, you need to use the keywords that they're typing in, definitely. But you also need to use the keywords around those topics. That's why Google Trends is such a good tool to use, because it will tell you about variations on a theme of the keywords that you're targeting. Also, if you've already got a site that's ranking for certain things, go and have a look at Webmaster Tools and search queries to see what people are searching for that are all variations. So for SEO Roadmap, I might rank for a whole bunch of other stuff around SEO Roadmap. But it's about using this logical, and if you're using graphics, there is no harm at all in doing things like using image title element. So, which is your little mouse over. When you put your mouse over the image, you get a little pop-up that says, hey, this is what this image is about. So crawl errors affect SEO. So I'm using the word SEO in there, but I'm telling you what the image is about. I'm not saying SEO, 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 okay? It's about logically putting all this information into the document or whatever that you're producing and making it easy for the user to understand and the Googlebot to understand. The other thing about when you're creating content, people say, oh, you got to have video on your page. It gets it ranked so much better. Video is the all-compassing secret for SEO. No, it's not. It's rubbish, okay? Some of my videos are rubbish, in fact. However, it's a good thing to have if you're going to do a video embed. Do a lot of text around it as well. Do a blog post around it. I never used to. Back in 2005 and 2006, I just used to do videos. But of course, they were only ever going to rank for their title, which is the only piece of text that Google could find at the time. These days, I always make sure that I accompany it, not only for Google, but for some people don't want to watch a video and hear me prattle on. They just want to read the blog post. So if I just summarize all of that again, so if you're building a new site from scratch, here are the things you need. Get a pen. WordPress. I would highly recommend for your theme to use a thing called Thesis. It's great. It's really good. Might cost you, I don't know, 50, 60 bucks, something like that. It's great. It's one of the best themes out there for WordPress. If you don't know what I'm talking about, speak to your web developer. Tell them you want that. The other thing that you need to do is then chunk out the site. What are the main areas of the site going to be for your content? You'll notice here I haven't got anything about contact us or privacy statement or our team or all that sort of stuff. That's all a given. That's all going to have to go in there at some point. And I'll probably block Google from things like privacy statements or, you know, disclaimers and stuff that has absolutely no relationship to the words that I'm targeting. Okay, chunk it out, and then under that, work out the subheadings. Then what you want to do, once you've done all that, is that you don't want to have a static website for, you know, forever and a day. You might chunk out big, high-level headings of the things you want to target. Chunk out then the smaller ones that you want to target on a weekly basis. Give yourself and put yourself together an editorial calendar so you know when you're going to publish. For me, it's every Wednesday. Religiously, I'm publishing a video and a blog post. And then next week, I'll tell you about how to get people aware, and not just the bots, aware of that piece of content that you've published and how we integrate social and SEO. And we'll see you next week. Thanks very much.